Bachelor of Engineering degree from Vishwakarma Institute of Technology, Pune. Sir has pursued MBA with Marketing Specialization from SP Jain Institute of Management Research, Mumbai. Sir has won MTV Chatterbox of the Year Award. Also, he has been awarded with academic rewards like National Scholarship. Parag sir has acquired 15 plus years of rich experience in project management in multinational organizations like Tech Mahindra, HCL, across the geographies of UK, USA, and India. He is an expert in managing cross-cultural teams in the domain of general management, operations, and sales. Out of sheer interest to serve the society, sir is an active member of renowned social organizations like Rotary Club of India and Roundtable India.
Good morning, all.
I thank IMER
management faculty for inviting me here and considering me worthy of having so many students listen to me. And Director Mr. Wang, Professor Shailaja, and other faculty members. It gives me a lot of pleasure whenever I talk to young students, especially business school students. Because I've been through that phase. I have been told to talk about two, three things. One is about the real estate industry, the kind of role one can expect from the audience if you were to work in such industries, and a little bit about our project that we are doing here with this Bella Vista. Is there any other thing that you would like me to cover from the audience? Any impromptu thing or a question you have? Not, then we can cover it with later. I don't have a ready-made presentation. I thought, let me talk to you as I feel, and the areas that I feel are from my own experience. When I was in B school, we thought we were Superman. We thought we knew more than our professors. We thought world's best companies would come and hire us. And we have already decided what we want to do in life. So it's like a case study, you know. You say, oh, in 3 years I'm going to become senior manager, and 5 years general manager, and then vice president, and 10 years I'll be CEO. Right? And the guy next to you is, hey, you know, I know everything. I know how to solve this company's problem. I know how PNG should have worked when they introduced Tide. They don't know anything. I was so completely wrong. Or most of us were so completely wrong, because in that gap of 2 years, just by solving case studies or reading some material or books like Kotler and others, we feel very powerful. But that was similar to, you read a lot of books on swimming or driving and you say, okay, you know what? Yeah, this is fine, this is how you take turn, and I think in 2 years I'll be as good as Michael Schumacher. And when you actually join an industry, you are hit with real challenges of business, which no case study can really prepare you for. And most of us think that I'm a specialized in finance, I'm specialized in marketing or HR, or HR is what I want to do, even if you're not specialized. When you actually work in a company, the lines are very blurred. When an HR person goes and meets somebody for recruitment, they are also marketing that company indirectly in that domain. And you as a marketing manager also have to take care of staff, so you also need to be a good HR manager. So there is nothing like a complete silo. Somebody may say that, okay, I'm a finance person, what do I have to do? I just sit and I do some math or I do some accounting. But if you do not understand how your company markets your product, then you will not be a very good finance person. I just wanted to give you this perspective so that all of us are really on the ground. You know, we, most of the MBA students are somewhere in the sky when they are studying. In the joint company, they actually come down, including me. The second thing is, all of us chart out our future plans. This is where I want to be, this is the kind of company I want to work with, and so on and so forth. But what really happens is, when you work in an individual company, you may realize that what the environment of a particular company is, it may or may not suit you. Or maybe there is a company which is a very small company, but that works very well for you. I had done my computer engineering. I did my MBA in marketing, so I went into IT, sales, marketing, project management. I worked in companies like HCL and Tech Mahindra. And after working for so many years, about 6-7 years in that field, I was in London with Tech Mahindra, and I decided to come back to India, and it was a totally different industry. It was a real estate development. So maybe it took me a lot of time to realize what I really wanted to do in my life, what is the calling that I have. That is, I realized that I cannot work in a structured company. If there is a very big department of 1,000 crore and somebody makes me a general manager of that, I don't like to run that. I like to work in a company which is very unstructured. It may have only 3 employees and then take that company to make it a 50 employee or 100 employee. Where there is a lot of ambiguity. Nobody tells you what to do, nobody tells you how to do it. So that is a startup kind of environment, which I realize I work best when I do that. So there is nothing right or wrong. Maybe you need to find what your calling is. And most of you are very young. It may come after 5 years, 7 years, 10 years. Do not get fixated. Do not say, I want to be only bank manager of Citibank. Because when you actually go and work like branch manager, you may realize, oh, this is not what I wanted. Because this requires a lot of admin work. I don't want to do that. But maybe that is what you want to do. So don't get fixated, be flexible, and be willing to do a lot of hard work and change when things don't work for you. There is nobody in this world, not a single person or not a single industry or a company, which has had a smooth sailing. The most valuable companies, one of the most valuable companies, Apple, was on the verge of bankruptcy. They had to take money from Microsoft, which was their arch rival. And people had written that off. In computers, they had less than 2 or 3% share. And today, we all go crazy over Apple. It has 500 billion kind of valuation. So let me come back to the real estate industry that some of you may be wanting to know more about. I want the audience to be a little more responsive. I'm going to ask you a few questions. What is the maximum amount of purchase that you have done in your life? You must have bought some mobile phones or shoes or jeans or you know, whatever. So can some of you tell me, one of the girls, what was the maximum amount that you think you have spent? Maybe you have bought a bike. Any guesses? $50,000? 1 lakh? Yeah, somebody bought a very expensive bike. Yeah.
30 lakhs.
30 lakhs? What is that? Okay. Yeah, but that's a flat, right? Okay. Anyone apart from that? What's the most expensive bike any of you have purchased? 12 lakhs. Wonderful. Okay. I think my point here was, in your lifespan, you are right now too young to purchase a lot of things, and most of that may come from your parents' money. The biggest purchase anybody does in the world is their house, primary house. Right? So that example was 30 lakhs. So even though 12 lakh bike was very, very expensive, 30 lakh was higher than that. So we case for Lakshmi Mittal. I don't remember the exact number, it was some 30 million pounds or something. Or we case for Mukesh Ambani. I don't know how much he spent, people put the value of the house as 1 million. Right? So we all talk about very expensive cars, bikes. Maybe certain vacations are very expensive. Maybe you can buy an aircraft if you're very, very rich. But in case of, let's say, Ambani, he has bought a Boeing also, and he has bought his house. So for a particular person, buying their primary house is always more expensive than any other purchase in their lifetime. So that is the kind of industry we are looking at, that is the kind of product we are looking at in real estate. Now that does not mean it's always very luxurious. We have a lot of levels in real estate. And there is one fundamental difference in real estate versus other industries. Most of the times when you buy your house, it is not ready. Right? So, if somebody tells you that, I can't show you the kind of car you will be getting, but I want you to pay 10 lakh rupees right now, and you will get your car after 1 year, most of you will not buy it. Right? You want to actually see, you want to test ride your bike or car or any other thing, even phone, you want to say, okay, show me the model phone, oh, fine, this is great, whatever, Samsung S5 or S4, this works, give me a new piece. The real estate industry is the one which works a lot on trust and faith. That is what promise a developer does. He has to, or she has to, fulfill that in certain time frame. Because the kind of money a customer puts is huge. It is also a very big ticket item. It is a very high touch item. People in the course of 1 to 2 years, and in some projects in bigger cities, they even take 6 years. From the time the project starts, booking to delivery. So you are in one of the most complex industries and one of the most expensive products. One of the days, I have about, I think, 8 or 9 MBAs working in our office. That gentleman had not shaved. I told him that, why have you not shaved? And he gave me some excuse. And I said, if you were selling a Mercedes car, would you shave or would you not shave or would you dress like this? He said, no, no, sir, I'll shave every day and I'll dress up and I'll be very, you know, tipped off. So I asked him, what is the cost of Mercedes car that is available in India? So he said, sir, I think 30 lakhs to 80 lakhs. And I asked him, what is the amount, what is the range of product that we are selling at Bella Vista? This is, I think, 40 lakhs to 2.5 crore. I told him which one is more expensive. So you have to put things in perspective, what it is. And as I said, it's one of the most expensive, and yet people don't see it. That is, the buyers don't see it. So you have to be very careful when you are trying to market. In terms of the activities for the students, real estate is one industry which is aspects of both manufacturing and services. I am sure you must be getting some companies for your placement which are mostly either manufacturing, so cement company or a car company. And or there are services companies like banks or other. But real estate is where you actually manufacture, that is, you make a building or a house or whatever. And there is a lot of service because the touch point with the person is very, very high with the buyer. So what are the aspects in real estate industry that an MBA like you can get involved? Like most of the companies, it has marketing function. As I said, the product is very expensive. The product, people come actually 5 times, 6 times before they really buy. It's a very high interaction touch point base. So there is a lot of marketing and sales aspect involved. Finance is very, very important. Because you need to plan, again, it's always multi-crore, 100 crore, 50 crore kind of project. So you do need to manage your finance, taxes, cash flow. Third is the project management. Project management is different from construction. Project manager is the one who takes the overall planning, that is, what are the dates? Is the actual construction team meeting those kind of dates? What is the expectation of a buyer? When do they want it? What are the challenges coming in? If there are rules or regulation, or there is new regulation which is going to come. So project manager looks for all the challenges, removes them, and makes sure the project is on time. Then there is obviously HR. The companies like us, we do not hire a full-time HR person because we are a small company compared to other large companies. We are about 30 odd employees. Yeah, we do employ indirectly about 300 to 400 laborers, but they are not our employees. So there is a section, a very small section of HR. There is a very small work on IT. We don't have a very huge IT requirement. But it's the finance, it is marketing, these are two large things. And third is the project management and land acquisition. Like in real estate, our raw material is land. So we always look to see, source, and acquire new land. Every year we look at around 200 land parcels. And how do we evaluate that? So it's again like a project manager, you evaluate this so many square feet, this is the pricing, and will this be cheaper for us or will it be expensive? What kind of rates we will get when we sell? The most exciting thing in my opinion in real estate is there are too many challenges. I get very bored when there are no challenges. That is, if you go and join a company, they hand over you a manual. Okay, these are the rules, this is how you are supposed to talk to customers, or this is how you are supposed to take care of the project, and that's it. Means if an industry does not evolve, if the industry does not innovate, then it becomes very, very boring, at least for some set of people. There are some section of people who are very comfortable because they want rules. These are the 10 things that I'm supposed to follow. But in an industry which is very, very nascent, in India, real estate is, I would say, equivalent of what it was in 1960s in Western world. We are still very, very manual. We have two, three, coolies that we call female who take this small six breaks on their head and go and walk. So I have an engineer who is from US, so he used to laugh. He says, so we do the math. It is very expensive for us to have those kind of manual labor. Instead of that, it's cheaper to take a machine which is costing 17 lakhs, which we just got. You dump all the bricks or the cement bags, and in 30 seconds it goes there, finishes the work, and comes back. So the way we are doing our work, even we have adopted a lot of modern standards, but overall what we are doing is like, it's like getting your shirt stitched, right? Still some people do that. 20 years back, almost everybody got it stitched. But now there is a significant portion of people. I don't think anybody gets their jeans stitched. It's mostly ready-made. Maybe people still do shirts. Maybe the people of our parents' age, they may still do that because they're used to it. Now, do you think after 20 years, let's say in the year 2034 or 35, there'll be any tailors around? Mostly not. Because, you know, the technology has evolved. There is a very good stitches, very good material, and a reliable product that you get. Plus, people do not have the kind of patience and, you know, oh, tailor has gone to his hometown because his daughter is getting married and now I don't have anything. You know, shadi ke liye jo diya tha, that's not ready. So people, the things are evolving to such an extent where, let me discuss about why I decided to come back to India. When I went to US and London, what I saw was most of the household already have everything that they need. Their needs are satisfied. They all of them have multiple cars, fridge, TV, washing machine. Maybe at that time LED TVs were not there, but at least they had LCD TVs or very big 50-inch screens. So the only business growth that would come is a replacement market. So they have a car which gets old, so they replace it. They have a TV which they don't like, so they want to go for a new product. Versus in India, India is like a businessman's paradise. Only 5% of the people, or even less than that, have a good house, a car, a computer, and a mobile phone. Most of us like to think India has become a developed country and we are doing very well, but that is only in the cities or larger cities. You go about 10 kilometers outside Belgaum and then you see what people have. They don't even have electricity. They don't even have good house. They don't have a good vehicle. Maybe they have a Mahindra vehicle or some kind of a two-wheeler. So imagine that is the 70% of India. When that 70 or 80% of India starts buying things that they have not bought in their life, washing machine, fridge, TV, iron, mobile phones probably they have, right? So you can imagine the kind of growth and business that India will have when that happens. And most of the times, if they are not able to buy, is because there is no electricity. It's not because they don't have money. They may have money, but in villages, they just don't have electricity. So they say, okay, what's the point in buying a washing machine which costs 15,000 rupees and most of the days I don't have power. So they're still doing the manual way on the stone and with the soap and all that. So the kind of growth we are looking in India in next 20 years is this phenomenal. So for you, it is an opportunity to try to find some industry or some function in a given industry which you feel, oh, this is going to grow a lot. Why companies are who are present in bigger cities in India? Like if you say bigger cities, there are about 7-4 metros and Hyderabad, Bangalore and Ahmedabad. There again, a lot of people have this product, the fridge, TV, car. But if you come to places like Belgaum, like I came to Belgaum about in 2007 or 2008 for first time. And I can tell you that as an outsider, I am seeing the kind of growth Belgaum has seen. In 2008, there were very, very few cars. And now you go to first gate at 7 o'clock in the evening and you see the number of cars we have. Right? You get jammed, sometimes it takes you 10 minutes if the railway crossing is closed. The amount of purchase people are doing, he was constructing, every other builder in Belgaum was constructing a typical kind of an apartment. They chose altogether a different track, different route. It is something like, you know, you are entering into some kind of foreign country. So that kind of feeling it gives. And very recently they have been bestowed with 5-star rating from CRISIL. Right? It is the only project in Belgaum, real estate project, which got that recognition from CRISIL. Amazing place, amazing team. Team always is important. Raj Bhandari, Parag Sarai, Shirur sir, Glenn from US. Amazing team, right? Working day and night to fulfill the promises that they have made to the people of Belgaum. So I again insist you please go there, have a look at that project. There are a couple of other projects are also, I think, they have ventured into. One is Bella Farms, which is in Ganeshpur, and another one is service apartments. Again, a new concept for Belgaumites. You will find service apartments in the city's metros. Right? Wherein you can rent out your bungalow also whenever you don't want. So these are all innovations that are happening in Belgaum. So we don't have to, you know, always look for innovation in the Western countries. A lot of innovation do happen in the city like Belgaum. As a sir said, you know, MBA is an experience. It is not a study. You cannot study MBA, gain knowledge and go out with, you know, saying that I am an MBA. That doesn't happen. MBA is an experience. So you should venture out, you should walk out, what is happening in and around. Talk to the people. So that's what real MBA is. right? And again, couple of very, you know, wonderful words of wisdom. Don't always seek social acceptance. That's where we mislead or misguide. Very important piece of advice. We always look for, you know, the collective wisdom to guide us. And maybe that is wrong for us. Right. So many things I think he has told us. In spite of, you know, he being not so well, some problem with his leg, till then, you know, he made it. And I personally saw him working day in, day out, and there is no timetable for him. You go anytime, he is there in Bella Vista project. So this is what is commitment, right? So all these, you know, good things we should try and learn. And maybe, sir, we will take our students in smaller batches to that project to see what's happening. What is innovation? Basically, we speak of innovation, but we don't see it actually happening. We will come and we will maybe interact in small batches so that they can ask a lot of questions to you. Right? If there are any questions, we will take otherwise.